Well, joining us here in the studio is banking law expert, Dean of the UST College of Law, Nilo Divina. Well, good afternoon, Dean. So good thank you very much for coming over.
Good afternoon, Dean. Nice to see you again. Yes. Same here. From our CJ on trial days, ANC presents.
Looking at how the AMLC can monitor transactions in the banking industry, does it actually seem plausible that they got hold of these data regarding the Chief Justice's accounts and submitted it to the Ombudsman without benefit, say, of a court order? Mm-hmm. Pwede ba yun? Mm-hmm. Mm.
Well, there are two kinds of transactions under the anti-money laundering law, Tony. Mm. Covert transaction and suspicious transaction. Mm. Mm-hmm. So covert transaction simply means transaction in excess of 500,000 pesos in one banking day.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So whether it's suspicious or not, once you reach a threshold amount, it must be reported to the AMLA. Mm-hmm. Now the other one is suspicious. Now that one is regardless of any amount. Mm-hmm. If any of the following circumstances is present, well, number one, there is no underlying economic justification. Mm-hmm. Number two, the client is not properly identified. Mm-hmm. Number three, the transaction is not commensurate to the financial capacity of the client. No? Mm-hmm. And number four is if it deviates from its usual profile with the institution. Then number five is if it is so structured to prevent reporting to the AMLA, meaning the threshold amount is 500,000 or more. Mm-hmm. So let's say they will break it up, no? 499, 400,000. No? Mm-hmm. And then the sixth one is if it relates to unlawful activity. Mm-hmm. And the seventh, the all-encompassing any transaction analogous to the foregoing.
Analogous.
Yes. Okay. So once the bank receives this report, mm-hmm. then it will, well, if there are covered or suspicious transactions, mm-hmm. the bank will report to mm-hmm. the Anti-Money Laundering Council.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So merong mm-hmm. obligations yung mga banks, yung mga compliance officers, di ba, that they follow yung obligations nila to report mm-hmm. these transactions to the AMLAC. Meron bang mga bankong hindi sumusunod?
Well, it's a crime not to report.
Yes. Yeah. Pero malalaman ba nung AMLA kung hindi ka sumunod?
Well, that's a good point, no? Mm. But because of the penalty imposed by the anti-money laundering law, banks do disclose transactions.
So sa takot lang nila na parusahan sila. What is the penalty ba for non-reporting?
Well, hindi, probationable naman, less than 6 years. No? But still, there's no bank official would want to have a stigma, no?
Yeah.
Would want to have a criminal record, mm. no?
Kasi yung nabanggit mo, no, if the person's financial standing
is not commensurate to this,
to the transaction.
That's
so,
right.
So isipin nila, kung kunwari si Chief Justice, no, may mga nag-raise ng point na magkano lang ba ang kinikita ng Chief Justice. Although, when the clerk of court, I think, hindi pala, yung budget officer pala ng Supreme Court took the witness stand at one point. Parang sinasabi niya, ang daming allowances kaya natatanggap mm-hmm. ng Chief Justice. No? Parang I think over a period of so many years, kumita siya ng 20 million, mm-hmm. o parang ganun, no? Yung banko ba mag-iisip na, if this is the Chief Justice, and he must be earning only this much, should I now follow that one condition and report kung bakit ganito yung amount sa mga tinatransak niya?
Kasi pag covert transaction, Tony, no? Mm-hmm. As long as you reach a threshold amount, mm-hmm. no need to ask any question. You just have to report to the AMLA. No?
Okay.
Now, if it is suspicious, mm-hmm. then the law requires a court order. Mm-hmm. The AMLA cannot inquire into bank deposits, funds or investments without a court order.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Now, court order may be dispensed with only if the predicate crime, you'll be surprised, no? If the predicate crime is any of the following, kidnapping, mm-hmm. hijacking, arson, murder, and violation of dangerous drugs law.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So if the proceeds of the lawful activity emanate from any of these predicate crimes, there's no need for a court order.
Mm-hmm.
Hindi ba kasali ang plunder and violations of the anti-graft law
kasama,
as predicate crimes? Kasama, di ba?
Kasama.
So let's talk a little bit about yung procedure in disclosing certain information, kasi I would imagine that the defense will make a case out of this, and already si Justice Cuevas already raised the issue yesterday. Can the AMLA disclose information upon the request of, say, the Ombudsman?
That's a very good point. So while there is an obligation on the part of the bank to disclose,
mm-hmm.
the law is not clear whether the AMLA can report or submit a report to the Ombudsman or any other government agency. Mm-hmm. That is debatable. It's not mm-hmm. clear in the law. No?
Mm-hmm.
In fact, there are many Supreme Court decisions. No? Well, basically, the Supreme Court said that the Ombudsman has limitations on its powers mm-hmm. to examine bank deposits.
Mm-hmm.
And one of these limitations is there must be a pending case before a court. No?
Mm-hmm. Oh, what about this one?
Well, at least the Ombudsman should request for the information. But in this particular case, the ombudsman got the information from the AMLA.
So ang the AMLA can only disclose certain amounts if it has already filed a case.
No, the ombudsman can examine bank accounts.
The AMLA can only disclose information. What are the conditions under which the AMLA can disclose information?
It's not in the law.
Not at all.
That's
not
debatable.
They have to file a case either with the ombudsman or the DOJ.
Under the law, they're supposed to initiate for future proceedings. Because the basic, if it can be established that the proceeds emanate from unlawful activity, the next step is to forfeit these deposits and assets.
So if it's not specifically stated in the law, by legal principles, ano dapat ang susundin natin? If it's not stated, meaning to say, it is not prohibited, it is not explicitly authorized, ano ang positive course of action dapat?
Well, the law has to be interpreted consistent with its objective or purpose.
Yes.
The objective or purpose is to determine if proceeds relate to unlawful activity, and the next step is to forfeit or initiate for future proceeding. So that is what AMLA should have done, to initiate for future proceeding rather than perhaps disclose to any other government agency.
And they were monitoring it, say, if we go by the report, from the period of 2003 to 2011. I mean, hindi naman natin alam kung kailan na-initiate yung pagbuo ng report, no?
Pwede naman kasing they looked at the record. So they backtrack since we have records since 2003.
Pero kung ganun, if there were records since 2003, doon pa lang at nakita nilang merong suspicious activity, hindi lang yung mere reported activity, covered activity, dapat meron na silang ina-initiate na legal action noon.
Oh, dapat they should have asked for a bank inquiry order to inquire into these deposits, no? And then once there's a probable cause that it relates to unlawful activity, then initiate for future proceeding.
Okay. Ang tinanong ko din kahapon, ang AMLA law supposed to be has a provision that it should not be used for political persecution or political harassment, di ba? O sabihin mo na nagpalit na ng administrasyon. So, 2009, 2010 na, di ba? All of a sudden, biglang naging aktibo yung AMLA sa pagsasaliksik nila. But before that, 2003 to before 2010, tahimik sila.
That's why the law imposes safeguards, no? The AMLA has to get or obtain a bank inquiry order. And in fact, there's a recent case, 2008, no? Republic versus Eugenio. The Supreme Court said, the AMLA cannot ask for a bank inquiry order without notice to the account holder.
So
the account holder must be notified before you apply for a bank inquiry order.
Notification lang, hindi permission.
Not notification.
Although if I remember the IRR of the of 9160, the AMLA law, it says there that the AMLA can obtain information and investigate certain records even without a court order. But as long as you have a resolution from the council itself, meaning the BSP and the insurance commissioner.
That has been changed by Republic Act 9194. Under RA 9194, only the Court of Appeals has the power to issue a freeze order. The AMLA lost that power, authority under the law.
So is that because, all this time we've had that law for
10 years.
10 years, almost 10 years. Yes. Since the original one is 2011.
2001, I'm sorry, 2001.
2001, But we've never heard of the AMLA, let's say, initiating a case for anti-money laundering or for feature.
There are cases.
They're just very quiet.
Very low-key. That's
very
right.
Discreet.
Yes, in fact, we have clients. No, we represent some clients whose accounts were put on hold upon this type of the AMLA.
So, by AMLA.
It's just low-key.
Okay. So what this impeachment trial now has brought out is that, in fact, the AMLAC can be very discreet and still very powerful because it can actually open accounts without maybe notifying the account holder. I mean, in this case, Chief Justice Corona, if he were actually notified by the AMLAC na binubusisi ang accounts niya, would he be, and this is the question in the minds of many, would he be that careless to actually put all these monies under his name and then move them so openly within the banking system so as to be tracked by the AMLAC?
The AMLA is very explicit that it covers even dollar deposit. Meaning the AMLA has the power to inquire into deposit regardless of the currency, whether Philippine currency or foreign currency.
So, walang FCB,
so RA 6426 cannot be invoked as an exemption when it comes to the power of AMLA to inquire into bank deposits.
They don't have to inform you that I'm inquiring, I'm looking at your accounts, I'm digging up your records.
The report does not make any exception, but before the AMLA can inquire into your deposits, they have to get a court order. from the RTC. Mm-hmm. But court order, as I said, not necessarily only in five predicate crimes. Mm-hmm.
The other thing that has emerged to be, not a surprise, siguro, no, in terms of how powerful it is, and we already know that the ombudsman is powerful, mm-hmm. is precisely the office of the ombudsman, kasi pwede pala niyang tingnan yung mga records na normally hindi inaallow, bank deposits, etc., etc. If we go by the strategy that they have taken in investigating the Chief Justice, so what should prevail? Is it the power of the ombudsman or the AMLA?
Yeah, that's a very good point. The AMLA, the law on AMLA is silent on whether or not the council, no, can report or submit reports to the other government agencies. On the other hand, RA 6770, the Ombudsman Law of 1989, no, empowers the ombudsman, no, to make the appropriate inquiries in case of malfeasance, misfeasance, or nonfeasance. No? So there is now a potential clash of two laws. No? Now, how the Supreme Court will interpret it, it remains to be seen. But at this point, it looks like it's more academic.
Do you want the Supreme Court to interpret
No, because the ombudsman has already taken the witness stand.
Perhaps
the Chief Justice should have gone to the Supreme Court and asked the ombudsman to stop and testify, but it's now more academic.
Sabi ko nga, tinatanong ko nga kay Attorney Adel Gapon, di ba may pending motion petition pa for preliminary injunction to Supreme Court? Hindi pa ina-actionan, di ba? Baka ngayon biglang, teka muna, this trial is moot, is invalid from the beginning. You know?
Well, mahirap na yata yun. We have gone this far. The other thing that emerged earlier, Dean, no, just as a final question, is that the ombudsman apparently gave copies of the AMLA report or the information she gathered from AMLA to the House of Representatives last Thursday, ahead of her testimony in the Senate. So, the very explicit in the AMLAC law, the AMLAC cannot disclose any information it has obtained through its monitoring of the bank deposits. But can the ombudsman do that, no? Considering that these are AMLAC documents.
Well, the ombudsman cited Section 26, no? And Section 22 of the Ombudsman Law. Mm-hmm. So while the ombudsman has no disciplinary authority over impeachable public officials, like the members of the Supreme Court, no? There's an exception. It can conduct the appropriate inquiry for the purpose of initiating an impeachment complaint.
That's the reason for sharing that information with the House.
That is what was invoked by the ombudsman.
Okay. But it's too early.
I mean,
one year prohibition. Does it cover
the next impeachment or will it apply to the ongoing impeachment proceeding? Is a matter that only the Supreme Court can decide it being a legal issue.
So, sabi ni ombudsman kahapon, perhaps by December.
But I'll give it in advance right now.